Welcome to this general introduction to Kakadu National Park, a World Heritage Area. My name's Don and I'm pleased to have your company on this visit to Kakadu National Park. I'm no expert on the park, I was only there for 3 days. I took A21 from Pine Creek to Jabiru and then A36 to Darwin. Of all Australia's national parks, Kakadu is Australia's icon and premier park. Next to the gate entrance, a sign welcomes us to Aboriginal lands. Kakadu is home to an indigenous population. Many indigenous works of art have been inspired by Kakadu. Kakadu is almost famous for its indigenous rock art, with some paintings dating back thousands of years. This is a painting on a cliff face at Nurlangi. We're on our way up A21 to Jabiru. The road is in good condition but very narrow and requires concentration pulling a large caravan. My friend Jamie sets up the caravan in Jabiru. A CD dedicated to Kakadu by Tony O'Connor. The park inspires considerable creativity. A classical work by Peter Sculthorpe has been inspired by the park. Many Australian stamps advertise Kakadu. The Jabiru, a long-legged wading bird, features here. Promoting the national park's bird life. The park also features many paintings. And other works of art. There are a number of DVDs available about Kakadu. There's also lots of published material, both plans and books.
Standing in the back door crying.
The park features a number of topographic features, islands and the coast, the wetlands along the coast, savanna and woodlands, and the interior rocky uplands. We missed the wetlands with the mangrove swamps. We drove through large stretches of savanna and woodlands that make up almost 80% of the park. The interior rocky uplands were fantastic. Will be the focus of the next few pictures.
Count the days I'm gone. Where there ain't no love, there ain't no getting along.
Such cliffs attracted indigenous rock paintings. Jim Kim Falls is well known and is famous. Billabongs attract a wide variety of bird life. Let's have a look. The Jabiru waves. An egret looks for fish. Magpie geese. The park is famous for its large numbers of fresh and saltwater crocodiles. These dangerous creatures are highly abundant. Setting on this short visit to Kakadu National Park. Thank you for joining me on this brief exploration of the park. I wish you a very pleasant day. I'd welcome you, viewer, to this historical information room journey. My intention is to make use of slides or photographs that I've taken of signs in Derby. There's some early exploration along the coast, but Derby as a town was not started until 1883, a fairly late point. It was probably chosen as an anchorage for ships, but also it's at the mouth of the Fitzroy River, giving a natural inlet into the vast interior of the Kimberley. Certainly with the arrival of a lot of cattle barons and the establishment of large stations, quite a substantial wharf was built at Derby as a regional center for the interior. A picture of the old wharf being serviced by a railway. A sign discussing the immense tides and in the mudflats the importance to the ecology of the mangrove trees. Notice the extensive root systems. Certainly in the early years, the importance of Derby lay as an administrative center for the export of cattle and sheep. Cattle were driven long distances. Today, cattle are taken by truck to Broome and exported there. Little remains of the early Derby cattle exporting business. Initially, cattle were driven on long trails annually, but with the development of roads, only by the 1950s and 60s, cattle was trucked in. A 1950s cattle truck shown here near Derby. Export figures on the huge numbers of heads of cattle shipped during the 1960s and 70s. Little remains today, just a few rails. Men at a cattle weighing machine. The pens were very small. A ramp for loading on board ship. There's interesting information about life in Derby around 1900. I know Derby was a large administrative center. They built a large hospital for leprosy, and probably 90% of all babies were born in Derby for the Kimberleys. The yearly mail service to Derby. Mail was brought in initially by ship, but later by plane in the 1930s. Photographed courtesy of the West Australian Batty Library. Large police presence was apparent in Derby, and much of their time was spent with dealing with Aboriginals. This picture shows Aboriginals in chains being brought in. This sign is about Derby over the years. Photographs showing wool bales waiting for export on board a ship. The maritime history. The old prison is mainly an open shed with a wire screen. During the 1880s, Aboriginal rebellions led to the correction of Aboriginal young men. Many of them were brought into Derby for shipment south to Roebourne. Men in chains here. An Aboriginal display celebrating their early way of life. An early Indigenous shelter at the display. A particular popular display is the prison boab tree. It was used as a rest point for police and escorted Aboriginal prisoners en route to Derby. It was recently fenced to preserve the tree. interesting that it says snakes are known to inhabit the tree, yet there are numerous photographs on Flickr and web shots of kids inside the tree. A 1960s photo showing the back of this immense boab tree. A more recent shot showing the entrance. It's possible for people to be thrust inside the tree to keep them as prisoners overnight. The railing's not really much of a barrier to stop people from climbing. A close-up picture showing the inside of the tree. Boabs originally came from Africa, probably drifted across the ocean, and they survived for a very long period of time. The Aboriginals had names for all parts of the tree and made use of its many useful features. Prisoners chained indigenous people outside the boab tree. A bit of an infamous history exploitation of a people. On a lighter subject, the picture of the interior of a boab tree set up as a British pub located as a tourist attraction somewhere in Africa. These trees really are immense. Thanks, dear viewer, for joining me on this brief history of Derby. Wish you a pleasant day. Welcome, visitor. Please join me on this trip to Bawali Visitor Center, Jabiru, Kakadu National Park in the Northern Territory, Australia. My name's Don. My friend Jamie and myself head off from our caravan through a 3-kilometer trail to the Bawali Visitor Center. The trail is pretty easy to follow. There are raised sections above the water, but no water in the dry season. We complete the trail and see a sign to Bawali, just pointed up ahead. I admire a parrot crunching on some fruit. The visitor center is excellent and well worth a visit. It's well laid out with a lot of information. I learned that it was begun in 1994. While Kakadu was declared in the World Heritage in 1981. The exhibits are well spread out and easy to access in my wheelchair. We gain an Aboriginal welcome. Now learn about the different tribes in Kakadu. There's a huge display built into the floor outlining the geographical areas of the park. I learn that there's small isolated pockets of monsoon forest in the stony country of the uplands. About 80% of the park is savanna and woodlands with eucalyptus and tall grasses, but it supports a surprising number of animals and plants. Billabongs abound. The hills and southern ridges are the results of millions of years of erosion. Along the coast are the floodplains. This may also be an area of lowland monsoon forests. Finally, we have the tidal flats coast and islands. Early rock paintings were pretty simple, mainly handprints. An emu is pictured below. Boomerangs were a feature of early rock paintings. That time it was believed to be less forest and more grassland. Below is a Tasmanian tiger, a now extinct animal. In earlier times, the climate was much warmer, and there were flying foxes which camped in the mangroves. Fish suggest an abundance of water in the floodplains. Hunters drawn in the X-ray style, they carry short spears used for hunting magpie geese. With the arrival of the white man, sailing luggers and hunters appeared in the rock drawings. There's a large display about termites and termite nests. A crocodile is mounted on the roof. Early uranium mines from the 1950s now have radon gas and can be deadly to enter. An interesting display about the early ranchers or pastoralists who settled in Kakadu in the early 1900s. I learn about the habits of the bower birds and how they accumulate things. Magpie geese. The skeleton of a gigantic crocodile. If one had the time, one could learn an awful lot about the range of birds, the many birds found in Kakadu. There's displays about the various areas in Kakadu. Well, we've done the educational part. Let's go to the gift shop and look around. Jamie buys postcards and I buy a fridge magnet. Time for a cappuccino. Lastly, we admire a primary school display about various ways people can care for the country. People put the rubbish in cans and walk their dogs on leashes. We head on the road back to Jabiru from the Bawawi Visitor Center. Once again, we take the cycle path back to Jabiru, about 2 kilometers in very hot weather. My name's Don, and I do appreciate your company on this trip to the Bawawi Visitor Center. It's well worth learning about the country. Welcome, traveler, to this visit to the Crocodile Holiday Inn in Jabiru, Kakadu National Park, Northern Territory, Australia. An aerial shot of the town of Jabiru showing the Crocodile Holiday Inn. Its unusual architecture makes it very distinctive. The town of Jabiru was constructed as a service center for the Ranger uranium mine, and the hotel was built at that time. Pictures of the hotel through the years. Hi, my name's Don. I stayed at the Crocodile Inn with my parents back in the early 80s, and then visited Jabiru again in 2007, but stayed in the caravan park. The main entrance to the hotel. The legs provide entrances on the sides. Jamie and I walk into the main lobby. We learn it's about $400 a night to stay here now. Why visit a hotel? Well, the Crocodile Hotel has some marvelous artwork and displays. Let me show you. There are lots of original paintings on the walls. They capture life in Kakadu National Park. This is one of the most stunning displays in the main lobby of a hotel that I've ever seen. It's a mammoth crocodile, probably a stuffed one, chasing a barramundi. There's an authentic Aboriginal fishing net off to one side. We're in the town of Jabiru, so Jabirus take precedence. They're a long-legged lake bird. A huge, impressive photograph of a Jabiru. Lots of artwork on the walls of the main lobby. Aboriginal art for sale in the main lobby. There's even didgeridoos for sale. Other items on display for sale. We decide to drop into the Escarpment restaurant for a cappuccino. Here, too, there's a lot of Aboriginal artwork on the walls to look at. The staff didn't even seem to mind me taking photographs. I photographed most of the artwork in the restaurant. Original Aboriginal or Indigenous hand waving. A nice painting of a waterfall adorns the walls of the restaurant. The roof of the restaurant features horizontal wall hangings with Aboriginal art. I was quite impressed to see this Indigenous dugout canoe on display in the restaurant. There's a lovely pool just outside the restaurant in the center of the Crocodile Inn. A good reason to visit the Crocodile Inn is a magnificent display of Aboriginal or Indigenous artwork on display in one of the corridors. There's actually too many to photograph, but I did take quite a number. Sit back and enjoy. My traveling companion Jamie and myself admire the artwork. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to record the artist or the information about each painting. There is simply too much. Lastly, we leave the hotel and walk to the nearby Kakadu Bakery for a bite to eat. It's not quite as upmarket as the Crocodile Holiday Inn, but certainly a lot cheaper. Thanks very much for joining me, dear traveler, on this visit to the Crocodile Inn in Jabiru, Kakadu National Park, Northern Territory. Have a good day. Welcome to this cruise up the East Alligator River in Kakadu National Park along the border of Arnhem Land. The Indigenous culture of Australia has always fascinated me with their ability to survive in extreme conditions. An early photograph of Aboriginal man crossing the East Alligator River in Arnhem Land. Today, many people of the Indigenous culture display artistic abilities. We like the idea of having an Aboriginal guide to teach us about their native culture. Information off the web told us that the boat tour could be booked at the border store near Yubir. The guided tour features lectures on the culture with plenty of views of huge saltwater crocodiles and other wildlife, including water pythons, geese, herons, ebri, and spoonbills. First, I had to figure out where the East Alligator River was, and on this early map, they're clearly marked the East, South, and West Alligator Rivers, all emptying into the common gulf. The Aboriginal art site of Yubir is located on the East Alligator River, and we needed to head east from Jabiru. This detailed map shows Sky Hills Crossing. The upstream boat ramp is where Bill and Sue caught the boat. I was unable to do the trip because of my wheelchair, so I waited at the border store and read a book and enjoyed a cappuccino. Jamie went fishing. Bill and Sue had already flown over the East Alligator River and taken numerous photos. They knew what to expect once they reached Arnhem Land, with the upland escarpment. We read about the tour on the net. It's about 2 hours in length and departs only during the dry season from May to October. It's $40 per person, and it's a unique opportunity to cruise the scenically spectacular ribbon of water separates Kakadu from Arnhem Land. The coastal tour takes you on the transition waters of the East Alligator River, where tidal waters meet river outfalls, where the rock country ends and the vast floodplains start. Your expert guide presents insight into the mythology of this rich Aboriginal homeland. We were camped 3 days at the Jabiru Caravan Park, and this ad at the park probably influenced the decision. We reached the East Alligator River at Cahill's Crossing. We're warned of the dangers. They weren't kidding when they said there was an extreme danger. Cahill's Crossing in the dry season. My friend Jamie went fishing for barramundi, keeping a wary eye out for crocodiles. He ended up losing his lures in the vegetation. I eye the river from the river bank. I don't think I'd see many crocodiles in that murky water. Bill and Sue board the boat and get ready to go, not really sure why they couldn't take wheelchairs. It's off and along the river. At first, the vegetation is savanna woodland. Is that a crocodile down there? Hard to tell. Bird life along the river. A fruit bat at repose. They're active during the night. Entering the escarpment country, the stony, rough uplands are becoming apparent. Aha! We're seeing our first crocodile. The narrow snout indicates a freshwater. This one's on the river bank, and it's a big one. The saltwater crocodiles are much larger and more aggressive, and won't hesitate to take a full-grown cow or horse. Steely eyes look hungrily. Another one crawls up the bank. The guide gives cultural information about the indigenous mythology. He's knowledgeable and does an excellent job. We reach the sandy plains of the East Adelaide. We stop on the river banks for another cultural lecture. Yeah, I wouldn't really want to sit in a wheelchair in that soft sand with saltwater crocodiles as neighbors. We learn about the art of indigenous weaving. There's information about throwing spears. It's time to head back to complete the 2-hour trip. There's more crocodiles on the other side of the river. Thanks for taking an interest in this trip on the East Alligator River in Kakadu National Park, Northern Territory. I do hope you have a pleasant day. Welcome to the short presentation on Jabiru Town, the tourist center of Kakadu National Park, located 250 kilometers from the capital city of the Northern Territory, Darwin. Jabiru is located in about the center of Kakadu National Park. It has a range of tourist accommodations, police station, small medical clinic, small airport, and a range of shopping options, including a large Woolworths. It was established originally as a service infrastructure for the new Ranger uranium mine, which is located nearby. With a population of 1,100 people, 20% of whom are Aboriginal, it doesn't appear like much from a small plain. It's quite a pleasant town to stay in, and even has a 4-star hotel, the Crocodile Inn. The hotel is unique in that it's designed like a crocodile. Some years ago I stayed there with my parents for one night at about $200. Now I think it's up around $400 per night. This trip I stayed in my caravan, which we drove from Perth to Darwin and back. We spent 3 days in Jabiru. Jabiru forbids the sale of alcohol, and consequently we came well stocked with our own beer from outside the park. My name is Don, and I appreciate your interest in this short production. Jabiru Plaza has a range of shopping options and is shown here on the map. Information noted that Jabiru was established to service the uranium mining company. Jabiru hosts a range of services for residents and tourists and is a gateway to the many amazing sights of the park. A quick look around the shopping plaza. A major business is tourism, with bookings for the many tours. My travel friends Bill and Sue did the unique cultural tour, which they found very good, and learned a considerable amount about the Aboriginal culture. Artwork on the side of a building. I was impressed by the Jabiru bus shelters, but the buses don't carry wheelchairs like all the buses in Darwin. A Jabiru is, of course, a wading bird. A historical photograph of an Aboriginal woman from Arnhem Land tanning a hide. Cyclones such as Cyclone Monica 2006 caused major damage. I think it's a good idea that alcohol sales are not allowed in the park. The entrance to the Crocodile Hotel. I produce a separate little video about this hotel with its amazing collection of Aboriginal artwork. The town has a clean modern look to it with underground wiring. There's a man-built lake with a large dam at one end and very green parks, as well as a cycle trail. The lake is very scenic and supports a range of bird life. I take my wheelchair on the cycle trail around the lake. The Lake's Back by Lars Kliss. Sobriety, a Bird's Life. Large numbers of fruit bats hang from the trees, while galahs frolic on the lawn. The town is well equipped with recreational resources, including a substantial golf club. No one would be upset at living in one of the company houses in Jabiru. The houses are spaces with green lawns. There's activities for the children and teenagers. The swimming pool is immense and very cheap. It was free for us at the caravan park. Near the caravan park was the Jabiru Sports and Social Club with tennis courts. There's even a university extension, the Charles Darwin, in Jabiru. The source of all the prosperity is the ERA Ranger Mine. Let's take a look. ERA is the Energy Resources of Australia Limited. During the 1950s, there was considerable prospecting for uranium, and many small uranium mines began around Kakadu National Park. There was considerable resistance to the mining of uranium, but during the 1980s, a large uranium mine was given permission in Kakadu, and deals were organized with Aboriginal elders. Early development of the mine. The mine is much larger today and ships its yellow cake for export to Darwin by railway. Today the mine is substantial. I was very annoyed that such a large mine does not provide any possibility for people in wheelchairs to tour the mine. The mine is still center of heated political debate, and there are many newspaper articles about infringements, contamination of people and machines with uranium. An Aboriginal ranger at work. Finished. It's great to have you along in this air flight from Jabiru around Kakadu. The airport doesn't serve as flights to Darwin, only local flight. The flight gave a clear indication of the geographical areas in Kakadu National Park, ranging from the wet lowlands to the savanna woodlands to the upland rocky sections. These photographs were taken by Bill and Sue. Unfortunately, being in a wheelchair, I'm unable to get into a small aircraft. I would have loved to have gone. We're into the air and look down at Savannah Woodlands, but not for long. It's only a matter of minutes until we hit the vertical cliffs of the rocky uplands. They're very impressive. And they extend on and on. Not really country I'd like to hike through. Bill's telephoto lens picks out unique structures. Riverbeds carve their way through the hills. Crocodiles love to sun themselves on these wide sandy beaches of the river. In spots, there's billabongs or small ponds with wet sands. This large wetland area is surrounded by mountains and cliffs. Fires are a frequent part of life in Kakadu Park and are managed as part of a scientific plan for controlled burning. Soon this will be an oxbow in the river when it cuts across the isthmus. Wetlands. We passed one of the major highways from Jabiru and we're heading back away from the controlled burns. We spot our destination, the town of Jabiru, with the crocodile Holiday Inn in the foreground. It's over the town with its artificial lake dammed up at the end and onto the runway outside of town. On the way we pass impressive cliffs not that far outside of town. I'd like to thank you, dear visitor, for joining me on this flight over Kakadu National Park with my friends Bill and Sue. I do hope you have a lovely day. It's a pleasure to have your company to Uber Rock Art in Kakadu National Park, Northern Territory, Australia. Sit back and enjoy. A website informs me that Uber, it's a sacred Aboriginal site famous for its rock art, with some of the drawings over 20,000 years old. Most of them were created about 3,000 years ago. They request no consumption of alcohol. It's about a 1 kilometer walk in, and I was able to do it in a wheelchair. But I wasn't able to make it up the short, steep hike to the top. Uru is located in the very northeastern tip of Kakadu National Park, on the park boundary with Arnhem Land. It's about 45 kilometers from the town of Jabiru. There's quite a bit to see and do when you're there, including a trip along the river, the East Alligator River. Quite a few people go barramundi fishing, like my friend Jamie. We headed out to watch the sunset at Uber. An informative sign welcomed us to the site. We could see that a rock escarpment overlooks quite a large wetland area, and it's here that the sunset views are paramount. A sign of Aboriginal elders asked people to take care of the site. One of the photographs is covered up, suggesting that the person may have died. When we started off, the landscape was traditional savanna woodland with small termite mounds. As we approached the Arnhem Land escarpment, the land became a great deal rockier. We were soon stunned by the unusual rock formations. Quite unusual. They went on for kilometer after kilometer, no end to them. Soon rock cliffs were visible, with overhanging ledges providing shelter points for Aboriginal art. You'd almost think that this was constructed for tourists rather than being natural. Or this very unusual rock formation. Would you trust walking underneath that bridge? After a kilometer's hike down a flat trail, we reached the Aboriginal art sites. It's beginning to get dark and we're in a hurry. I have lots of praise for the trail. My electric wheelchair handled it easily. Unfortunately, there was no access to the actual rock sites. I was unable to see the art in person. My friend admires the first sight. You can see how it's sheltered from the weather with the large overhanging rock. Some of the drawings are apparent here. Information on how the rock art was actually produced by the indigenous culture. A lot of the rock art was difficult to decipher. This one is pretty obvious, a kangaroo. There's a lot of information on the web about the individual styles and periods for the rock paintings and the myths and legends that are associated with each one. For instance, this one is showing a hunter, but it shows a characteristic dynamic figure tradition. This is visible, but what does it mean? You could spend weeks becoming familiar with the traditions and myths and styles, and it's not my purpose other than a brief introduction, and we only had a short time before darkness fell. This one is exceptional. It's a Tasmanian tiger which became extinct on the mainland about 4,000 years ago, so it really is an old rock painting. I don't know much about rock paintings, but I do know this was called the X-ray style, where the interior skeleton was drawn in the painting as if it was an X-ray. I'll be honest, a lot of the literature about the paintings give them a lot of hype, but when you look at them, it'll take a lot of work to decipher what you're seeing. Let me show you what I mean. Okay, this is easy, a turtle. But tell me what you see here. It's like a Rorschach test in psychology. Or here. Interesting, but the mythology and interpretations escape me. I'm sure I could find out if I researched. My friends Bill and Sue hiked to the top of the escarpment for sunset shots. You can see where they were from here. Egrets frolic in the wetlands. A daylight view from the top. The sun is setting in the wetlands or in the distance. And the sunset blooms over the wetlands. The sun is set to the west over the wetlands, and we bid farewell to a burr. Bill and Sue head down to join me at the trail. Thanks, dear viewer, for joining us on this trip to traditional indigenous rock art. I hope you have a great day. Welcome to this quick visit to Noorangi Rock, Kakadu National Park, Northern Territory, Australia. Reaching Noorangi Rock involves a trip south from Jabiru past the Bawali Visitor Center, 19 kilometers, and then a 12-kilometer turnoff. A tourist write-up on the walk, 1.5 kilometers. The rock shelter with the rock is located on the south side of Noorangi Rock. As shown by this small map, There's lots of activities from climbing to the top of the rock to doing a number of walks in the region. An article in The Age saying it's getting a little crowded here, dated 2005. Over 200,000 tourists were visiting Kakadu National Park annually, and almost all of them went to Nulangi Rock. It's not surprising that there's a large number of high-quality blogs, loads and loads of photographs and information about this rock site. It served as a shelter for thousands of years, providing windows to a rich indigenous spiritual tradition. The paintings are reached by a circular 1.5 kilometer walk. Another blog tells us that the road, the path, is very well maintained and wheelchair accessible. This blog tells us that the rock is 1,900 million years old, constructed of pebbly sandstones with an interesting milk quartz pebbles that give it a strongly speckled look. The collection, pronounced Arnbarnbarn, I'm not sure if I got that right, was actually painted in 1964, probably repainted, and David Attenborough filmed it in 1962. The site has inspired a lot of artists, such as Peter Sculthorpe, who wrote a serenade. A view of the rock. The pathway leading to the rock. Interpretive information about the importance of dance to the indigenous culture and the actual rock painting. It's possible here to see the surrounding rock. One of the most famous rock paintings, The Lightning Man. There's myths and traditions associated with these art drawings. Unfortunately, I haven't done the research. Some are not that clear and are difficult to interpret. Wetlands are found below the rock. Bird life is abundant, particularly in the wet season. It's the dry season now, and the birds struggle with the lack of water. It's still very scenic. A few water lilies bloom, in spite of the scarcity of water. Thank you for visiting with me Nulangi Rock in Kakadu National Park, Northern Territory. Have a good day.